Hey, everybody. How are you? Welcome to the show today. It's Friday. It's 4 p.m. Pacific. It's time for Pathfinder Friday. I actually kind of messed with Jason just a little bit right before I pushed let's go. I started a conversation with him, and there was no end to it. Yeah. So, yeah, that's just a little joke. Nohar, how are you? Welcome. Welcome, everybody. Thanks for joining us. It is the very last day for some of us for a while until the new year.
That's right.
And so... what we're going to do today is we're going to have an update, kind of a state of things with the playtest, because it's been a little while since we've heard anything about it.
It's been a while.
And it's been a while. Copyright strikes. I got to be careful. No. Copyright strikes. I'm sorry. Maybe I spilled the water. I don't know. I might have. Merry Christmas to you, Steve. Thank you for joining us. We're going to have an update. It's been sort of a black hole of information about the playtest, and there's a reason for that. And to find out that reason and to find out what else is going on, today in the studio, we've got the one and only Jason Bowman in the house. Jason, welcome.
Hello. Yay. Hello, Dan. Thank you for having me.
Yeah, no.
Always happy to be here.
I noticed, Jason, right off the bat, I don't want to make a big deal about it, but you don't have a hat.
You know, the funny part is...
Jason, don't worry.
We actually...
I brought you a hat.
I don't... What?
There no, you go,
I didn't,
buddy.
I didn't.
Yeah.
You're welcome. Oh, come on.
It's got ears on
it. No, it does. All right. Well, fine. We're doing this then. All right.
A good shot of that.
Sure. We'll make sure we... Oh, that's going to be nice and noisy. All right.
It is going to be very noisy.
So we're festive now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you know. Yeah. You know, it should be a goblin. You're right. So this is the thing. Nohar's absolutely right. It would be really cool if those were goblin ears, but they're elf ears.
Well, we'll have to work on that for next year.
But that's not to say that next year we won't have such a good idea.
That Paizo-branded holiday hats with goblin ears. I think we've got ourselves a winner here.
I think you're right. So, Jason, thanks for coming on the show.
Thank you for having me, Dan.
We've got some, updates might be the right word. Updates may not be the right word.
Well, update not in the sense of there is a new update coming for the playtest, but update in the sense that we want to let everybody know what's going on.
Yeah, fair.
You know, since Thanksgiving, we've kind of went quiet. Right before Thanksgiving, we wrapped up the Doomsday Dawn playtest.
Mm-hmm.
On the Twitch stream, and after that, you know, we had released our last update at that point in time, and we just kind of went dark, and that wasn't entirely intentional. We kind of realized that we missed a blog opportunity or two in there that we probably should have tried and taken advantage of,
mm-hmm.
but we just kind of had a lot on our plates. As it turns out, having thousands and thousands of people playtest your game gives you a lot of information to work with.
I'm sure it does.
So,
also, before we go too far into this, we want to let people know that the surveys are still open. Right?
Yeah, absolutely. That's okay, the thing, right? So the thing that's most important for everyone to get out there is that the surveys are still open until the 31st. So at midnight on the 31st or thereabouts, all of the surveys and everything will close. Everything will shut down. And from that point forward, the playtest is officially over. But between now and then, you can still get that last-minute survey data in. So if your group is still playing, get that data in. We are still analyzing that data. I was just looking at surveys earlier today.
Okay.
So, we're not done.
Okay,
Not by a long shot.
Good. We finish our live stream, the Doomsday Dawn stream. That wraps up.
Yeah.
Then you guys go into data mode, where you're grabbing data,
that's right, yeah,
crunching numbers,
yep,
looking at feedback from the surveys and
the message boards.
And the message boards, okay.
So what we did is we've been spending the past, well, and to be honest, this has been happening since almost the beginning.
Okay.
But we've been gathering data, trying to figure out, you know, how was the game playing, what was working, what wasn't working, and what needed to be fixed.
Okay.
I want to say about a month and a half ago, we tried to identify all of our big trouble spots, the things where the data was clearly showing us there were huge problems with the game. And by huge, I mean they're huge by our scope.
Right.
It's funny. It's like what's big for us is like, oh, we're going to change these eight numbers. That's a big deal.
Right.
But for most people at home, they'll be like, something changed? Oh, that was nice. I think on one hand, we identified a lot of the problem areas of the game that the playtest showed for us. And, you know, to be honest, over the past month, we've been really heads down trying to make the game better. We're in kind of our crunch. where the design team and I have been working very long hours, often over the weekends, to try and get as much of this game developed and ready as possible. It's been a rough couple of weeks. The design team is going into the holiday break, and it was like yesterday. I was like, "All right, everybody, we'll see," because I have a bunch of my team members out today, even. And I said, "All right, guys, I'll see you in the first of the year. And here's your stack of paper to read on the way home. Here's your stack, and please send me your files via Teamwork." So we're all going to our own respective parts of the country to enjoy the holidays. And all of us are taking work home with us. Right, so it's a busy time for us right now. But I have to say, I'm really excited. The game that is coming together is phenomenal. It is really great. I'm really happy with how things have turned out.
Awesome. Before we look forward,
yeah,
let's look back.
Sure.
So let's just give a brief, quick overview, review, look back at the playtest. Overall, how do you think it went?
So I think it is interesting. I think, you know, when we started this whole process, we were like, okay, we're going to put out an adventure because an adventure allows us to remove a number of variables from the play environment so that we can kind of really get at the numbers and how the game is playing. And when we started that, we were like, great, everyone's going to love this. It's a better way to test. I think the thing that we missed was that it is, in fact, a test. It's not a game as much as it is a test, and tests can be hard. Mm-hmm. It's hard to make a test fun. And we did our best, and a lot of groups really had an awful lot of fun with it. But it's clear to us that some groups were like, wow, this really wasn't what I signed up for. And, you know, sitting here grinding away at, you know, demon encounters is fun in theory, but when you're on your third hour of it, yeah, it grows a little thin on some folks. And, you know, I think the upside is we got a lot of great data out of it. It told us a lot about how the game was working on the boundaries, which is some of the hardest stuff for us to get data out of, because everything we do internally is so anecdotal. It's like, oh, well, we played it, and I guess it went okay. Mm-hmm. But you don't really get to really explore the edges of the game space until you get a lot of feedback. So there have been ups and there have been downs. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, there are some things that we looked at that we thought, hey, we'll give this a shot. And some of those didn't turn out too great. And then there were other things that just went better than we could have even imagined. And, you know, so we're going to keep that stuff. We're going to fix the other stuff and hopefully end up with a game that everybody likes.
Nice. Okay. And then along with that, all of the data that came in and all of that sort of thing, I think that combines with the feedback from the message boards. Now, the stage that we're in right now is combining all of that data into a snowball, as it were, to say, what happens with this now? Yeah. And that leads into the things like homework over the vacation.
And, well, and, you know, we've been hard at work for this past month revising all 12 classes. They have all been being pushed through their paces. So all of them got more pages. Mm-hmm. All of them are getting new content. A lot of them are getting revised content. I would say that about 25% of the feats that were in the playtest are now gone to be replaced with different feats. So they're not.
Gotcha.
We're not losing content. No. We're taking out some content that wasn't quite doing what we wanted it to. It might be as little as 10. It's between 10 and 20%. And we replaced that with even better stuff. Mm-hmm. And for a lot of these, you know, there's just a whole lot of things we've been doing to them to make them a better expression of what they need to be. So that's been our big push lately. Right now, we kind of got past a lot of our deep mechanical issues that we were trying to fix up. A lot of the math stuff got resolved, and we're really happy with the direction it's taking.
Great. I'm seeing in the chat, like, Nohar is saying that their group fell apart just because of scheduling.
Oh,
it had
sure.
nothing to do. Now, this is the thing.
It was very aggressive.
Boy, oh boy. It was a fast guy. Like, because I was here running the games, you know, behind the scenes at the controls, running the ones and twos, as it were. And I was like, this is fast. This is a really quick schedule that we're doing.
Yeah.
And, you know, and my and Monday.
We didn't even have time to play at all.
My Monday night game.
Yeah.
That I do gets canceled a lot because of, you know, conflicts and everything. And so I you know, Nohar, I completely understand what you're talking about there. Like, just, you know, having all of those regular issues that happen and then throwing, you know, the fast schedule on top of it, that it was really kind of difficult.
There's no room for error in that, yeah. Right? You know, if a group misses a handful of sessions, you're now permanently behind and you don't have a chance to catch up before it runs out of time. So we kind of knew that going in, which is why we were like, play what you can. Every bit helps.
147. I remember
from
the beginning.
Yeah, 147 if you can't play them all. But if you can play more than that, just play as many as you can. As much data as you can give us is good.
Right.
I think on the whole, you know, we did see whenever you do something like this in a large series, you always see kind of a marked percentage drop off from part one to part two to part three to part four to part five.
Right.
The upside is all of that fell right within our predicted model of what that was going to be. So we were like, okay, yeah, it's what we expected. So
great. And well, that was my next question is even though there was some drop off.
Even
play right into the schedule. Like,
yeah, and even part seven had enough feedback for us to give us the data we needed.
Right.
I would say that part one, which had over like 15 times the data we needed in terms of numbers,
right.
Had thousands and thousands of responses. That is amazing and awesome. But even when we got to part seven, it had enough that we were able to tease out the data we needed.
Right. Okay. So that brings us to around the Thanksgiving time, because when we planned out the Doomsday Dawn stuff, it was we sat down and looked at the calendars like this has to be done before Thanksgiving.
Yeah. It's actually why part one only got one session.
Yeah.
Because we realized that if we gave it two, it would end on Thanksgiving and we couldn't do that.
Which, so. and admittedly, that made our schedule even shorter than you know what we wanted, but I think that people started trying to track with us and you know it kind of led to some issues, some
why we also gave everyone till the end of December.
Exactly.
Right? Have a whole extra month,
right?
Give us your data, and it's still very useful to us. So I mean, you know, right now we're in the wrap-up process, so you know, if you got one or two sessions left and you can get those in before the 31st, great. And to be honest, even after that, if you want to keep playing, right? I mean, enjoy the game.
I'm sure that Roll20, their VTT, they have Pathfinder playtest stuff in there. So it's there if you want to use it.
I am shocked at the number of people who I have started to see who are like, well, the playtest might be over, but I'm going to convert Rise of the Rune Lords, or I'm going to convert. And we're starting to see people do their own online conversions of some of our old APs, which is crazy. And But it is really cool because so much of this is so easy to convert. You just pick up new monsters, put them in, and you're pretty much done.
Right.
There's a little bit of behind the scenes work, but it is not much as long as you're not trying to invent new stuff right now.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. So what overall, what else have you guys been doing since Thanksgiving? Because really that is kind of when the communications
That's when we went dark.
Yeah.
Yeah. We went dark because we had had a massive meeting right around then. And I mean, admittedly, there also like PAX Unplugged was right after that. So some of us disappeared.
It was a lot of stuff.
It was a lot of fun, but it was a rough couple of weeks. So after that, you know, the team all, we huddled together, we talked about what the issues were, and we just started creating like an agenda list of this needs to be fixed, this needs to be fixed, this needs to be fixed. And then we've been spending the time from then until now lining those things up and just fixing them, going through the files, changing rules, changing documents, reshaping parts of the game to be more what we want. We've also been doing testing. Internally testing like our new numbers scheme and things like that, where we will get a thing together, run through half a dozen playtests just to make sure it's close to what we need it to be, because we have so much data telling us how one number is performing. As long as we do more testing on if we shift that number a bit and test, we're pretty confident that we're in the right spot. So in this case, that we did a lot of that, and we've been just working and working and working. Right now, I think about half of the book is through our redesign.
Right.
The other half, I would say about a quarter of it, is going home with the rest of us through the holidays. Right. And the other quarter will be in early January.
So if anybody decides to do a holiday drop-in and visit one of the design team folks, there's a good chance that there might be a...
Yeah, no, odds are if you can track us down. No, I mean, don't do that.
Well, you know, I'm just saying,
the holidays,
you never know.
You know.
If
somebody bursts in on Steven's Christmas dinner, he's going to be cranky.
You don't want to do that.
He has knives.
Yeah, no, don't do that. I'm joking. Don't do it. And just also, so you know, I put a bottle of water down there for you.
Oh, handy. Water, so oh, thank
that's
you.
That's there for you.
How many more versions of the dying rules have you gone through? Enough is the answer. Enough.
So, let's. Okay, so usually, and folks that have watched more than a few episodes here of Pathfinder Friday with Jason knows that Jason is pretty good about bringing a list, a top five list of some kind. And I was like, well, I guess we can't do the top five thing because usually it was about what the update was going to be and all that kind of stuff. And Jason said, oh no. Mm-mm. Jason said, I can bring you a top Mm-mm. five. Jason, can you tell us what you brought?
I am bringing you the top five things that you can look forward to in Pathfinder 2nd Edition.
There you go. So so this would be changes, not big spoilers that we can go into detail about, I assume.
Yeah, I think I want to add a couple caveats before I start on this list. First of all, we're not done yet. Right. Second of all, some of these things might still adjust and change a bit between now and the end. So not all of these are fully implemented yet, and I probably don't want to go into too many details because I just want to give the basic idea of what's going on, and then we'll save more details for in the future. Because this, the playtest will close on the 1st. We got a blog lined up to announce the end of the playtest and everything, and then the design team is probably going to disappear into a hole for at least a month or two,
right?
Depending on how things play out. And during that period of time, we're going to be deeply, deeply hard at work. So that's our real, real heavy crunch time. And not just for us, but also for editors and graphic designers as they turn this back into a book. Because we
bring it back out
into Word documents. So there's a lot of work to be done.
If you had to guess, because I'm trying to think of some of the bigger conventions that are customer-facing. Because we've got some of the like trade shows and stuff. But like we've got, do you think there would be something ready to go by PaizoCon?
Absolutely.
So we'd be able to see some of what the final is going to be looking like.
Absolutely. There's a handful of shows in the early part of next year that we're looking at to see where we can show off parts of this game.
So you just got called out. It's the good old nothing is final. We know you'll ignore that and freak anyway.
Listen, I have to try. I want to tell everybody about some of the excited stuff we have going on here. But I also am trying to walk that fine line of, I want to tell you awesome things. I can't wait. But I also don't want you to necessarily freak out. All right.
Yeah. But that is very
I don't think any of these, perfectly timed. I don't think any of these are going to cause anyone to freak out. Well, maybe one or two.
All right, Jason. We'll see. So are we going in reverse order? We start with number five?
We start with number five.
Number five.
Number five. This one's really straightforward, and it's something that people asked for since the beginning of the playtest. Number five is just polish and flavor. This was a big push for us throughout the development of the book. And what we tried to do was we looked at all the rules and mechanics we had, and we realized that a lot of them were accurately written, but they're pretty dry, right? They're like, oh, they just launch directly into rules, and they don't bother giving you any sort of idea about what the flavor of the thing is.
Okay.
So when we looked at going back through the rules, one of the things that we really tried to do was make sure that everything we put in the book has plenty of flavor to it and plenty of explanation kind of describing what it is. So instead of just immediately launching into rules, we try and give you some context. So I have a little bit of an example here.
Great.
One of the things that we gave out in the update 1.6 is we gave rogues new ways to specialize. So they could be a dex rogue or a strength rogue or a charisma rogue. And they were all very rules oriented, telling you what your new thing is.
Right.
But we looked at that and went, that's really cool, but it needs a story behind it. So we decided to call it your racket. Your rogue has a racket.
Okay.
It's your rogue's racket.
Yeah.
And what it is it describes kind of what type of rogue you are, where you got your education, the organization, and the sort of shady dealings you probably had.
Totally, yeah.
Yeah.
So it's like, what's your racket?
Yeah, what's your racket?
I got it.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah. It gave you a way to talk about your mechanic in a in-world way that made sense.
I like that. I like that idea.
Yeah.
That's what sucks you in. That's what makes you, like they're saying in the chat,
taking a mechanical thing and turning it into a narrative thing.
Yeah.
Because a lot of the stuff in the playtest had really good mechanics, but the narrative was a little thin, so we really worked to edge that out. And as we added new things to the game, mm-hmm. we also added that flavor right along with it. So I'll give you one more example, and this one's one of my favorites. Wizards now, when they graduate, when they become a wizard, so when they leave their master and become a wizard in their own right, they have to turn in basically what's called a thesis.
Okay.
And the thesis is basically your specialization in wizardry. It's like, oh, you really care about familiars. You studied up on familiars. Oh, you're focused on metamagic and that sort of thing. And ultimately, it's like, well, that's just a mechanical choice, and that's certainly true. But one thing that it is as well is it is a way for us to color your character. So we encourage you to actually come up with a kind of full title of your character's thesis. Nice. So it might be your familiar thesis, but in reality, it'd be like, you know, my thesis was on familiar bindings and how the meta, you know, physical properties can be improved through the application of treats and further sorceries. And it's like this long flowery thing, and everybody else in the group just stares at you like,
yeah,
nerd.
Yeah, I was going to say, you nerded it up. I love it.
Wizards are the nerd of the game. Yeah. So, you know.
So this is really cool. So adding flavor, it's taking things that are saying like, look, this is a rule. This is a thing. This is how the game has to run. But let's take that and put it in a package that says it could be this in real life. And this is how you can relate to it.
Yeah.
Which I know for a fact, because I see people every day talking about our products.
Yeah.
It's, you know, it's the flavor, it's the world building, it's the narrative that brings them in.
And this gives us a better way for the story to become manifest in the game. So that's something we're really excited about. And it's not just rules. It's how those rules get turned into your story.
Awesome. I like that. And the best part is like something like the thesis or the racket, you know, you're creating your character just by having fun and being like, well, this is what they do.
Yeah.
And it's got a part to it. So
it gives us so much room to expand and do cool, fun things with these as well.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So there's a lot of fun things.
Okay. That's number, is that number one?
That was number five.
Wait, we're going backwards.
We're going downwards.
But that's the first one. That's just the first one.
That's one.
Okay, Jason.
That's number five.
Number four.
Number four. I rewrote chapter one.
Okay.
Entirely.
Okay.
So chapter one is there to serve as the introduction to the game.
Oh, right. Yeah.
And the introduction that we had in the playtest rulebook left a lot of people going, I'm confused. This seems more difficult than mm-hmm. I thought it was going to be. And we dug into why that was. We spent a lot of time in our survey data trying to tease out why chapter one was giving people so many problems. A big part of that was it wasn't being used as a teaching tool. It was being used as a reference tool. And that's a big difference.
Yeah.
So it was doing a lot of things like, oh, attacks can be, you can find out more on attacks on page 384 or whatever the page number was. And it was like, well, that makes it seem like you should go there and read that now, when in reality, what we're trying to do is teach you a narrative. So it now includes an example of play. It starts out with a piece of fiction. It has a kind of, I wouldn't say lengthy, but it has a complete treatise that walks you through in a narrative way all of the major terms and pieces of the game.
Great.
And then uses all of those to walk you through an example of play. So the entire point of it is to help you build your understanding of the game instead of just kind of throwing you in the deep end and asking you to go look up charts and tables.
Exactly. Okay. So it's more of a journey. It's more of a come with us. We're going to start playing this game.
Yeah.
Okay.
And to that end, we also redid the way we built characters, and we included a complete sample build of us building a character using the rules we just presented. So it's really exciting. We're about to take that into internal testing to make sure that the chapter actually works. We have a few people on staff, and I don't even think they know this yet, that spoilers, that haven't played the game. We have very few people on staff who aren't gamers, but we have a couple.
Right.
And I'm going to ambush them with all of those chapters and make them use them to make characters, just to see whether or not the chapter is doing what we need it to do.
Okay, great. So the non-gamers at Paizo, be careful.
Yeah, you're on notice. But if you're not a gamer, you're probably not watching this anyway, so it's fine. Still won't know.
Nobody at Paizo watches my show. What are you talking about? I don't
even think they know when it's watching. On. We know Marlon's watching.
I don't even think he is. I haven't seen him in the thing.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, I know.
We could do whatever we want.
Shh. Don't tell them there's no mod in the chat right now. I like that. So it's more of a an introductory journey type thing. Come with us. Let's learn how to play this game.
I will be totally honest. I spent like almost 3 or 4 weeks digging through online seminars and tutorials about how to teach complex topics to adults.
Right.
I learned a lot. And we actually contacted some folks who have some teaching experience to help get their opinions on this, because really, Chapter 1 needs to be there to teach you.
Absolutely. And you know, and this is the
rest of it's a reference.
I'm gonna borrow from Frank Herbert, one of my favorite authors, by the way. Dune, one of my favorite book series, from all the way to the end. But not that other stuff by his son. Sorry. But, you know, he starts off Dune with, you know, the beginning is the most delicate of times. Like, the introduction of everything is so important, because if it doesn't bring you in, if it doesn't say this is what we're about, then people are just going to close the book and go away. Yeah. So I think that's a great thing to work on.
Which is why I started out with a piece of fiction that I struggled and hemmed and hawed over for a long time. And it starts off, although this might get changed a little, but the first word spoken in it is, Aridin is dead. He's not coming back to save us this time. It's awesome. It's awesome. That's gives
great.
Me tingles.
It's great.
It's awesome.
Okay, that was good. That's number
four.
That's number four.
We're down to three.
So, Jason, can we please move on to number three?
Number three. We also, it's not just all on the player side of the screen. We also took a very hard look at the GM resources. In the book. So, you know, players are obviously a big focus of a playtest, but we got a lot of data on GM resources and how some of those were working and how some of them weren't working. One big thing was we got a lot of feedback about how the table of DCs was a big kind of convoluted mess. So we streamlined that. That is now a simple to read table. It has one level line, one list of numbers. That's it. It's a regular formula. It's easier to understand. And it helps out with point one on here, but I'll get to that later.
Okay. All right.
In addition to that, we looked at things that were causing GMs a lot of headaches, things like conditions. Mm-hmm. Conditions were causing a lot of headaches at the table because some of them were really close to one another. So we looked at the conditions and we found ways to push some of them apart. We deleted a one or two of them that weren't doing the job we needed them to do. We kind of created a condition that said, your strength is sapped. We created a condition that says your dexterity is sapped. We created a condition that says your constitution is sapped.
Ah, okay.
And then we created, and most of these are adaptations of conditions we already had.
Okay.
So they're not actually new. We just streamlined their abilities to be like, the dex damage condition basically says, take a penalty on all your dex rolls.
Okay. All right.
And dex stats. So because we did away with ability damage from first edition to second edition, these kind of help fill that spot, which is what we need them to be.
Okay.
But we did one thing that we, this is my Christmas gift to GMs. This is my favorite thing we invented. And I was talking to the team and I was like, guys, I have a problem with conditions. We don't have a condition anymore that's so horrible that the players desperately don't want it. And the moment they get it, they get afraid and they want it to go away. So we added one, and it's called Doomed.
Doomed?
If you get this condition, it's...
Doomed is awesome.
If you get the Doomed condition, it doesn't have any effect on you, except for the fact that it reduces what dying threshold you can go to. So Doomed 1 means you die at dying 3. Doomed 2 means you die at dying 2.
Oh, no.
Doomed 3 means you die at dying 1. And Doomed 4 means that you die.
Oh, man. You know, okay, chat is right. Colonel RPG, it's not Doomed. It is Doomed.
Doomed.
Sorry, if you're wearing headphones, I'm sorry about that.
Yeah, no, you got to get the big exclamation point on there. Doomed. Yeah.
I like this. I really like this. Okay.
Yeah.
So that is one of those things that, again, it says, GM, here's a little golden ticket to put in your pocket that you can actually threaten and really genuinely threaten your players.
Yeah, very powerful undead and very powerful necromancy spells will drop this on you.
Yes.
You really don't want the Doomed condition.
Yeah, and actually, that's exactly what I was thinking is I'm going to sing the Doom song now. from the cartoon, you know? Doom-doo's Gurg. That's what I was trying to not think about it, but Chad's got my back. I love that.
Invader Zim was great. That cartoon was awesome.
Great, great. So, Doomed. Okay, so that's number three.
That's my gift to GMs.
That's a really good gift.
Merry Christmas, GMs.
That's number three.
Yeah.
We've got moving on to number two.
Number two, Resonance.
Everyone loved Resonance. Wait, am I remembering them right?
No.
Everyone loved Resonance.
No, everyone hated Resonance. and here's the thing. We always knew Resonance was a big challenge, and we wanted to see how it played in the system, and turns out it didn't. So it's gone. That's it. We did away with it.
No more resonance at all. It's done. Okay.
No. The only thing that we're keeping from that, and we did a focus test as well, like that was like, here, we're going to test this focus system. That didn't really quite work either. It wasn't that people didn't like it. It's that people were too split in every different direction.
Absolutely.
No, but nothing was winning a majority, which means none of them were actually meeting people's needs. So we just got rid of all of them.
Okay.
The only thing we're keeping is a limit on the total number of magic items, permanent magic items your character can wear.
Okay.
Other than that, you can use whatever magic items you have on your
All list. Right.
So we're in the new year. Goodbye.
Jake
Resonance
Bacon
is doomed.
I like it. That's a good one. Resonance is straight up dead. Yeah, well, there's that. Okay, so that's going to be a welcome change for a lot of people. I think Nohar, you know, has a point. Everyone loved to hate Resonance. I think that's also true.
It became the rallying cry for everything that people didn't like about the playtest.
Yeah.
And we get it, right? It was the one thing that everyone was like, this breaks my verisimilitude. So we fixed it. It's gone.
Okay, great.
This will require us to go back and change a handful of things. And I think wands are getting kind of a redesign as a result, just to be something kind of different and unique. Because just more, you know, a stick of scrolls is not really a very interesting item and really was a 3.5 construct anyway. So we're going to look for some more interesting things to do with wands as a game space. But other than that, I mean, you want to chug a bunch of potions? Chug a bunch of potions. We're fine with that. We found some satisfactory ways to make that work in the game.
Nice. Okay, yep. Great. And then that brings us to the number one. Preview or
the number one thing to look forward to in Pathfinder Second.
There you go. Number one thing to look forward to in Pathfinder.
So, throughout the playtest, everybody who played the game, you know, they looked at the way pieces were coming together. They looked at how their numbers built up, and they said again and again, proficiency makes a lot of sense, but it doesn't feel like the numbers mean much. And we looked at it, and we looked at it, and we looked at it. And we got more data, and we looked at it some more, and we said, yep, you're right. So we're changing the numbers.
Okay.
Yeah.
In a major way.
Yeah, in a pretty big way.
Okay.
To make them more impactful, we have changed it so that untrained is now 0.
Okay.
Trained is 2, expert is 4, master is 6, and legendary is 8.
Wow, okay, going up to 8. Okay.
Yeah, going all the way up to 8, which means the difference between someone who is legendary and someone who is untrained is almost the difference between a crit
and a hit.
Yeah. It is a significant difference.
Wow.
You will now see that those characters are pretty far apart in things. And most player characters aren't untrained in anything except skills and some aspects of like weapons and armor, but like no player character is untrained at a saving throw or perception or anything like that. And throughout play, you will find that there are many ways that your character can now improve their proficiency in various scores.
Right.
So that, you know, even a wizard eventually becomes an expert at simple weapons. Or the weapons that he's trained in, right? He eventually learns how to swing his staff a little better than when he started. You know, he starts out trained, but eventually he gets expert. Whereas someone like the fighter who still gets legendary and becomes a true master at weapons.
Right, right.
So this has really opened up some of our numbers. And remember before when I mentioned that we changed some of the target numbers and stuff? On the GM side, we made the chart easier. Well, part of that was making it so that players who specialize in a thing become better and better and better at that thing over time. It's not like you have to keep sinking everything in it to stay at 60% success rate. Fighters at high level on their best attack, assuming they're fighting an average foe, will hit on their first attack like 95% of the time. We've made that happen now. Right, they will hit very frequently.
Yeah.
But that's because that's what they're supposed to do.
I like that. I like that it speaks to the, you're trained, you're good, you should have this.
So what we did is we started out looking at the number system from skills, and we said, you know what, if you become legendary at a skill and it lines up with your ability score and you have an item or two or maybe even you don't, you should still be at the point where you almost automatically make average checks with that skill.
I agree.
And because you're a high-level character, that's what you wanted to be, so we should let you do it, right? That's how the game should work. And for somebody who just dabbles in it, we still want them to have a decent chance to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And then if you don't do anything for it, well, you should be pretty bad at it, right? I mean, you should basically not be attempting those things. So the new math system, along with a number of other changes to the way that system comes together, makes all of that work so much better now. It helps people be the role that they need to be. But it also, says, hey, you know, if you want to dabble in a thing, you can at least get competent in it. But its specialization is where you really become a master at things, and you do buck the curve.
Is it level plus 8 or is it just flat 8?
Oh, it's level plus 8.
Level plus 8. There you go. So it is
unless
not
you're
messing
untrained.
Around. Unless you're untrained. Which, I mean, you know.
You don't get your level if you're untrained.
It's just a flat 8.
No, it's nothing.
It's nothing. If you're
untrained.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
You don't add anything except for your ability modifier. It's not good.
Yeah.
At low levels, you can attempt ordinary tasks. So if your wizard never picks up athletics, you can try and climb an ordinary pine tree, and maybe you'll do it, maybe you won't. Mm-hmm. But you're never going to get good at it.
Right, right.
You have to put something in skills at the very least.
That is awesome. Get good at it. I like this.
Yeah.
All right. And so basically, Steve, we just listened to you. Steve asked, these are exactly the changes that Steve was asking for.
These are exactly the changes that everyone was asking for. So as it turns out, when everyone asks for a change, we tend to listen and give it to you. So happy holidays, everybody. We've been listening to everybody since the playtest started.
Yeah, absolutely.
And, you know, looking at the way some of those numbers worked and the way some of those pieces worked was a thing that we had to let fully test. Mm-hmm. We needed to see how it played, even up at the highest levels, because that was the spot where we had some things that we were worried about the system.
Right.
And that was the thing that convinced us, we have to make a change here. This isn't working the way we wanted it to. There are these weird situations where characters become good at a thing that they've invested nothing in.
Right.
They're not great at it. They're not doing Herculean things.
Yeah.
But they are doing things that average people probably couldn't do, and they're still pulling it off, and it's just because they're high level.
Yeah.
So this does have some side effects, right? You know, it's like one of the things that we liked about the old way the math worked doesn't do this anymore. Like if everyone goes down and you have the MacGuffin sword that you need to kill the demon, and the only person left is the wizard and he's not trained in it, your party is really screwed because he's not good at that. He's not going to be rolling well.
Absolutely.
On that. But that's the price we pay.
Yeah.
So, and to be honest, if you end up in that situation, you're probably pretty screwed at that point. Anyway.
Yeah, so, definitely.
Whatever.
So let's do this. Let's. Those are your top fives.
Yep.
That's it.
Yeah.
Thank you for the update. And
thank you for giving
preview.
Me the opportunity. We didn't want to go totally silent through the end of the playtest,
totally.
And I appreciate the getting a chance to chat with you and the fine folks.
Yeah.
Here on our Twitch channel.
Absolutely. Let me do a sign off
for
the YouTube folks,
and then we'll do some chat.
Do
yeah.
I don't know how much Q&A we can't really. We'll figure this out.
We can talk about stuff.
It'll be a journey. We'll figure out together.
Yeah, we'll figure it out.
All right. So thank you so much for joining us. If you had a good time with this video and learned a lot, which I know I did, I actually didn't know any of these things beforehand.
Secrets.
This was all brand new for me too. Because you can tell because I'm not that good of an actor. So it was new info for me. We do this every Friday, except for next Friday, but we do this most Fridays at 4 p.m. Pacific. And we would love to have you join us next time. We're at twitch.tv/officialpaizo. I'm doing a sign-off with the YouTube folks right now, but after that, we're going to do some Q&A with the chat here on Twitch. So if you'd like to be a part of it, join us sometime, won't you? In the meantime, if you like the video, give it a like, give us a follow, hit the bell. And just help us out in general that way. Let us know. Mention in the comments how your playtest experience went, and now what you think about the next iteration that's to come after hearing what you've heard today. And in the meantime, I hope you have a good holiday, or you had a good holiday, I guess, because this is going up after that. And so for Paizo and for Bowman over here, and for me, I'm your old buddy Dan. Thank you so much for joining us, and we will see you again next time. Bye.
Bye-bye.